birthday bash. We are duo TPK, and we're hanging out in Hartford, doing the things.
Yes, doing the things, like staying inside, washing our hands, and being safe curmudgeons, and at least in terms of me, introverts. Mm-hmm. So keep doing that, and this is a concert, an incentive of the things that can be done from the indoors and safety of one's own apartment.
Yes.
And a bunch of instruments.
And a cat.
Yeah, he's, I don't know if you can see him, but Astro's kind of hanging out here.
Literally.
We're trying to see how loud and obnoxious we can be before he GTFOs his way back to her room.
Yes.
But, yeah, so this is going to be, as you may have noticed, not your typical recital. I don't have shoes on, but you can't tell that. We're in our PJs. It's gonna be a little cash. Gonna be a little intimate. As intimate as one can be from the comfort of one's home, over the internet. So sit back, relax, grab some coffee, grab your cat, and we're gonna play some saxophone music for you.
We're gonna start off with my friend Gala Flagello's piece, Burning Day, which we premiered at the International Navy Band Symposium in Virginia, and we also played it at NASA and at HART.
Not to be confused with the space organization, this is the North American Saxophone Alliance.
Or Space Camp.
Biennial conference at it was in Phoenix this year at Arizona State University.
Yeah. And a little bit about this piece. I asked Gala to write this piece primarily because, well, the whole set. I commissioned both Gala and Joseph to write a duo piece for us to premiere. And the purpose for premiering these pieces and having them write these pieces was because we were all about to go through a little bit of a change with grad school coming up, leaving, moving. And so this piece Gala wrote on the purpose of the Phoenix and the rising and falling. And she has a little note here that I will read to you because I think that it is best to hear what the composer wrote. Burning Day is about the life cycle of a phoenix. The work does not trace the mythological creature's death and rebirth exactly, but rather explores the idea that the phoenix symbolizes both destruction and renewal. There is something really poignant about the grand and beautiful animal bursting into flame and becoming a gray and papery ash, a feeling that humans experience as well as move through different stages of life. Both ones that build us up to our highest potential, and those that feel like the end. In the later case, we look to find how we may be reborn from our own ashes.
All right, do you want a note?
I would love a note.
Thank you.
So the next piece that we have for you is something, was the other piece that Giovanna commissioned in the set that she was talking about. It's a piece of mine called Chrysalis, and it was premiered along with Burning Day at the Navy Band International Saxophone Symposium and the NASA Biennial Conference in Arizona. Chrysalis is a piece that is it's an exploration for me as a composer to explore color between two saxophones with as little complexity as possible. The idea of sort of the title came from in terms of Chrysalis came from this idea of, you know, you're looking at one thing here, and then behind it there's something moving and something that you can't quite see. But you feel and you know that it's there.
They're saying that they can't hear us.
They can't hear us. Well, that's,
sorry.
That's
let's,
not a good way to do this.
Let's fix that. Let's see what Emily has to say. Hello. You can't hear us. That is great. Let's see what's happening. Hard to hear us when we're talking.
Oh.
So let's, I guess,
this talk
louder.
Oh, we can hear, but they can hear us when we're playing? They can hear us when we're playing?
Yeah. Maybe we can just,
huh?
Tiny bit? No?
What,
okay,
what do
on.
You?
Like, adjust the gain?
No.
Okay. Bye, camera.
It's not a, we'll just talk louder.
Okay. We're gonna talk louder.
premiered it in Navy Band, at the Navy Band Symposium and the NASA Symposium, NASA Conference rather. And it's an exploration of color between two saxophones with little amounts of complexity. And it's the idea of Chrysalis that you can see something here and something behind it is moving. Hopefully you can hear this. You definitely saw the hand motion. And hopefully that'll make sense. Anyways, this is Chrysalis. Thank you.
that you could hear everything. It kept buzzing. Now we're going to play a piece by Jenny Citarelli. Thank you so very much, Jenny, for writing this piece. It's called Conversations. And it's for Barry and Alto. So.
How are we doing on sound, though? Are we good?
Yep.
Yeah?
Yep.
Cool. I need a note. Gotta get it.
Thank you.
But besides the two pieces in the beginning that were commissioned, most of the pieces on this program were submitted specifically for this concert in a score call that we sent out 2 days, 3 days before. There was just like, anyway.
Well, we found out that school was canceled on, I guess, 2 Thursdays ago. I was upset because today was supposed to be my recital, my senior recital. So I posted on Facebook and I was like, I'm sorry to say my recital has been canceled. And Gala Flagello, she was just like, why don't you just do a duo recital? I'll send you duo works. And then we ended up talking on the phone for like 2 hours and making it work.
So, yeah, so Jenny's piece and Conversations, the next piece, and I think the next two or three pieces after that, were submitted as a part of this score call for this concert specifically. And we just like to just up front thank all of the composers that had pieces ready or rifled through their portfolio to find works for us to play, and it's really fun not only playing music from living composers, but playing for the most part new works, or at the very least new arrangements, like this piece from our good friend Dan Minogue.
Yeah, so Dan Minogue sent us a very alto piece originally written for alto, bass, clarinet, and he sent us a little bit of notes regarding it, and it says, I started writing this as I was trying to process the genre dubstep, a genre I still allow into my ears, but as you will hear, don't yet fully understand. Dan, me too. But by allowing the influence into the composition, I was able to develop riffs and variations to facilitate a joyful, intense banter between the two instruments. Both have the space to show off as well as produce a powerful groove in tandem. Dan, we've had a lot of fun learning this piece. Thank you.
So, it's very groovy, very funky, very fresh, and this is I Dub V.
I just have another real quick.
Thank you.
Definitely left. I've been trying to teach him how to like saxophone. In the 2 weeks that he's had here, he has heard too much saxophone. With us home, at least. Gala Flagello again. It's called Dear Joanna. It's for
Johanna.
Johanna, sorry. Sorry, whatever. And this was originally written for alto saxophone and trumpet. And it is a piece relating to the fugue, which one?
The Beethoven's Grosch Fugue.
Grosch Fugue. Yes.
So specifically in the program notes, Dear Johanna meets the challenge of relating. Well, let me go further back. Unique instrumentations such as the original one for this piece, trumpet and saxophone, were assigned to the composers with the task of relating each new piece to Beethoven's Grosch Fugue. Dear Johanna meets this challenge by using a retrograde of Beethoven's subject as the most prominent pitch material, while illustrating the real life custody battle between Beethoven and his sister in law Johanna over her son. So, like all the other pieces, it's kind of angsty. But if you want to find the Easter eggs, there is, a pretty clear melodic material from the fugue. And, hope you enjoy. it got bigger.
It did.
It went through a growth spurt.
It did go through a growth spurt. Can I get an A, please?
Yeah. Is one you may know very well. It's a nice arrangement of Danny Boy, provided to us by composer Brendan McCormack for alto saxophone and tenor saxophone. So sing along if you can. We won't be able to hear you, but you know, togetherness over the internet as best we can.
Here we are.
Yeah.
Actually, I want to do this real quick. Sorry. I keep missing my foot pedal. Blends into the carpet. Okay.
Aesthetic. This is a piece given to us by Nathan Scalise.
Scalise,
entitled Nest for alto, and you wrote some notes about it. You want to talk about it?
Yeah. So Nathan sent this piece to me because he writes duets for him and his wife, and I thought that was really sweet, and I really like this. It's called Nest, yes, and he and his wife are a French horn and trombone pairing. So.
Which part's which?
So the alto part is the French horn, I'm assuming, yes. And the tenor part is trombone.
Dope. It's called Nest. It's pretty. We like it. I whistle it all over the apartment.
It's kind of funny.
Thank you. instrument switch here.
Yep.
Joseph, would you like to speak about your piece?
Yep.
The piece de resistance.
I don't know about, well, no. maybe piece de resistance.
We've played this piece for too long.
Thanks.
No.
Yeah. So, I'm going to go back a little bit here because I wrote some good stuff. So this is the last piece of the program. Not part of the score call and not part of the original collection. This is a piece I wrote a couple years ago, originally for
Billy Beecher,
alto saxophone and bassoon. And while we were rehearsing and premiering it, I kind of came to the realization that this would be pretty great on alto and Barry. So I did that. This version was originally premiered, I think, last year or 2 years ago at one of the regional North American Saxophone Alliance conferences with me on alto and Bradley Karras on Barry. And so it's been fun learning both parts to my piece. And so this piece is called, I think I said this, but this piece is called Shred It. And it really is me sort of figuring out metal music on saxophone, and the specific program notes are, all my life I've been a self-described, secret metalhead. The level of intensity, power, and sincerity of that particular genre of music has perpetually resonated within me. When I found out that my good friend Billy Beecher drove around New York with his radio dial fixed on hard metal stations instead of classical music stations, our friendship deepened, and I began to explore the side of my compositional voice. I'm beginning to notice a developing trend in my chamber works in that more recent pieces I've written are simply excuses for me to perform with my friends. It's true.
And
roommates specifically. And when I approached Billy about writing this piece, I knew from the beginning that it would be metal. A discerning ear can hear much of the influences of metal in general. But regardless, it was a treat to unleash my inner head-banging, angsty teenager while writing this and also performing this a lot. So, yeah, here's some Shred It. For those of you that have heard this and know the audience participation section, feel free to do it on your own, but you will not be prompted. And also, just be aware that we are gonna shout at you a little bit, but don't be. It's a little scary, but it's all gonna be fine. we'll talk to the rest of our apartment complex after this, I'm sure. But here you go. Here's some Shred It. Get some notes happening.
Yeah,
let's
go.
Thank you.
tuning in. Hope it sounded good. And
stay safe. Wash your hands. Do all the things.
Stay indoors.
Post pictures of your cats. We want to see your cats.
She wants to see your cats.
I want to see your cats.
And enjoy the quarantine. Things are crazy, but you know, we're all in this together. And thank God for the internet. And have a good rest of your Sunday, everybody.
Have fun.